you that you restore everything in our lives. That God, we can come before you here and sit in this seat in front of you. You know, we're just praying in the back, and it's just so refreshing to remember that, you know, when we come into this house, how we see ourselves, either in terms of what we do or how other people see us, all that falls away at his feet. Because God, when we come before you and we see ourselves the way you see us, you say that we are lovely, God. So Father, we thank you that you wanted us, that God, you said, we are lovely in your eyes. God, we come before you and we thank you that even in front of you, even in front of all of the things that are going on in this world, that God, you are still Lord yesterday, today, tomorrow, and always. That God, you are always going out before us. That ever since the beginnings of faith, that you've always led your people through the deserts, through the battles, through the trials, that God, no matter what changed, you never changed, God. And so, Father, we just let your truth wash over us this Sunday, that God, we are accepted, we are loved, we are wanted, that God, you fought for us. And I just feel like, you know, a lot of us, we know that we need to be good Christians and worship God and do the Christian thing and put our hands up. But I feel the Lord saying, you know, it starts from that place of knowing how much he loves you. That it's first, we love him because he first loved us. And so God, we think upon that cross. We think upon that love. We think upon the veil that was there between us, where you were the perfect Lord and King of Kings, and we were here on earth just, you know, crying out for a Savior, and how you sent your Son to tear that veil so that we could be with you, God. We thank you. Sing some songs, but I used to do this thing as a kid. You know, my mom is here, and we had a dog when I was growing up. It was a little Shih Tzu. They're those kind of like Ewok-looking little white fuzzy dogs. And I remember, like in fifth or sixth grade, I was trying to wrap my mind around God's love for me, and it was such a foreign concept, but it sounded weird at the time, but I would imagine, you know, because God says he sent his Son to die for us, and there's no way I could relate to that because I didn't have children at the time. And so I would think, like, oh, I wonder what it would be like if I sent my dog to die for other people. And it's kind of a silly thought, but it really hit me, even as a kid. You know, something so innocent. And now that I do have kids, you know, I imagine what it would be like if I had to send my children to die for people that rejected me. And how that could be called justice. And it occurred to me that what we think is right is not truly what's right, but God's way of justice is so much higher, where to him it's right to send his Son, the only innocent person in this world, the only one who is right, to die for people who rejected him. God, you are just so amazing.
that though you are fully Lord, you would do that for us. Though you are fully King, you are also fully Father. So we just declare, God, over every single person in this room, your love is real. That John 3:16 was written for each and every single one of us, and God, in response, we just say, we thank you, God. We thank you that every morning your love is new, your mercies are new, your favor is new, that God, you are for us, not against us. God, you are the God that led us through the night. You're the God that freed us from our captives. You're the God that died for our sins. You're the God that provided for us in the desert. And you're still the God for every generation. You're still the God that carries the church today. So Father, today we just envelop our praise in you. That when we sing this song, it's not just a song, it's not just music, but it's something we can put our spirits and our faith behind. Every generation. That though the enemy tried, he could not quiet the sound of your worship from the beginning of time. God, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you.
Lifted high, oh God, battle. I'll sing through the night. Oh. falls down from the heavens is the holiest name, as all else fades away. You're my heart's desire. I hear the sound shaking the ground. It rolls down from the heavens. It's the holiest name, as all else fades away. You're my heart's desire, Jesus, Jesus. Yes, you are.
trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken.
Sunday, if you weren't here, you probably heard what I said about the depression I went through. Brian, you weren't here, so I had to repeat it again so you would know. And I talked about the depression I had when I was in San Diego. And a year ago, it was pretty much the same thing. And this time last week, Brian, I went to San Diego. And I went into this depression again. You were from San Diego. Maybe that's why. And I took time off and just kind of work on myself, of course, rest, number one. Number two, have this dialogue with God. I don't know about you guys, but it's good, it's healthy to have dialogue with God. Is that okay to say that? So in this dialogue with God, and I remember, I felt like the Lord's asking, the Lord's saying, is it okay? Is it okay that you're pastoring a church filled with broken people? Is it okay if I give you all these people that are broken, dysfunctional, distressed, and broken? Is it okay? I said, Lord, it's not okay. Can I be honest with you? It's not okay. I want everybody to be like Brian, to be like Sherry, all on fire for the Lord. Exactly. I said, God, I want everybody to be on fire for the Lord. They're actively, proactively serving God, and everybody move like a military. How many of you like that kind of church? A church on the go. Yes. We're all fired up, passionate about Jesus. Every time they worship, they lift up their hands and just throw themselves on the ground and worship God. How many of you like to belong that kind of church? I would, but God says, no, I'm gonna give you broken people. Just look around. Okay, quiet down a little bit. I'm talking, please. They're trying to mute me. I'm joking. I'm making more depressed. No. That's not what I'm intending to do. And I understand why God's doing that. Earlier today, you guys weren't here. Maybe only one or two people were here earlier today. Our sound system didn't work for 20 minutes. The worship team, they didn't have sound. We could hear on the live streaming, but over here, there's no sound coming out of the microphone. And our worship band, I have to tell you, they really threw themselves out. They were screaming and praising and just worshiping God without the amplifier, without the microphone, without the instruments didn't work. And I tell you, that was one of the best worships that I've been in for a long time. Well, you can clap, don't be cheap. Oh, I have to tell you, and I saw our teams, our sound team, they're like pulling their hair, they're running around like, you know, headless chicken, like, what do we do? You know, the best thing to do is call Orson. Orson, we need help. And I saw Orson walked in with a baby in his arm. And I saw his face. And I said, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for people. They're not, according to the world, doing a successful thing. They're not making it work. Everything's kind of falling apart. Everything's not working. But it's because this safe environment, they're able to give their best, even though they fail. And after worship, everybody stood up. I had everybody stand up, turn around, and applaud everybody in the back. And they did. The applause lasted for a long time. It's like when you went to a concert and everybody would stand up and applauded the performers. And afterwards, I went to the back. I said to one of the guys over there, I said, "It's okay, good job." And the brother said, "I did everything wrong, but why did they applaud me?" He felt bad. I said, don't feel bad. That's what family is about. That's how we would need to do family together. We're creating a safe environment for people to grow. We're receiving broken people, dysfunctional people, people who need help, people who are going through tough time. That's why we're called together to be a family, to do family together. I remember the Lord told me that, "Is it okay that all these broken people will come to this church? Is that okay? Is it okay if all the sick people go to the hospital? Is it okay that when they come to this house, they're not only restored, they're also able to help other people restore? Is that okay? Is that okay when people make mistakes, we still go to them and say, 'Good job. I know you're doing your best. Even though you don't know how to turn the button, you know, the switch on, it's all right. It's okay. I've also come to tell you how to do it. It's okay. But next time you'll learn, I'm pretty sure. Next time you know what to do or what not to do.'" Anyway, so I had a dialogue with the Lord, and I wasn't okay with that. Is that okay if I tell you that I wasn't okay with, you know, what God said to me? "No, God, I don't want to, you know, do family with a bunch of broken people." No. And God said, "What about you? You're a broken one too. God, I don't want to be with all the prodigal sons. They got problems. They got issues. George got issues." I don't know why man would want to wrestle with another man. I mean, he's got issues. He's like, I don't know why man want to do jiu-jitsu. But joke aside, and I said, "God, I don't want to." And is it okay to say no to God? We try. And he's so gracious. He said, "Slowly." And I said, "God, it doesn't matter. I'm yours. I'm yours anyway. And I'm really proud of this house. Honestly, I'm really proud of this house. Give them a round of applause and give those people in the back a round of applause. I'm really proud of this house. Even though I said, 'No, God, I don't want to be with these broken people,' I have to tell you, I'm a broken vessel as well myself. And I think it's okay to be broken, but it is not okay to settle with that brokenness. It is not okay to feel broken but not willing to get back up. And it's not okay not to put hope in the Lord because He's able to restore. Is that okay to say that?" So anyways, I remember as I was going through this process, and I was reminded, somebody always come to me and ask me, and they would say, "Jack, how come this church, you know, you don't talk about offering? You don't talk about tithing. You guys don't collect tithe. You don't collect offering." And I always smile, like, "Yeah, you know, whatever belongs to the Lord belongs to the Lord," and all that kind of answer. And I was reminded of a story in the Bible where people came to Jesus and said, "Jesus, shall we pay taxes?" Right? We know the story. "Shall we pay taxes?" I know Jackson would say, "No, we don't want to pay taxes. You know, IRS is beep, you know." Anyways, so, but Jesus said, "Bring me a coin." We know the story. "Bring me a coin." And Jesus asked them, "Whose face is on the coin?" And they'll answer, you know, George Washington. Kaiser. Kaiser's face is on the coin. I like to use that illustration John used last Sunday. Did you have that $100 bill? You still have a $100 bill? I'm going to borrow that later. And whoever's face on the coin or on the currency, and that belongs to the person, right? So whoever the face on the coin, you know, you want to give it back to Caesar. It's pretty much what Jesus said. And Christians nowadays, we're debating whether we need to pay taxes. Do I tithe before tax or after tax? You know, like, what's the percentage? I'm like, that's not a point. I said, Jesus used this analogy to tell us that you and I, we all have the image of God in us, in our life. You're created in His image. So you are like that coin. You have the image of God in you. So you belong to God. Is that okay to say that? You belong to God because there's an image in you. There's an image of God in you. And you belong to God. So I don't talk about tithing or offering, because if you know whose you belong to, you throw your life to Him. You just lay down your life to Him. You pray the prayer of, like Isaiah, God, here I am. I'm all yours. Send me. Use me. I'm yours. A lot of us, we don't know whose we belong to. We think that our life is ours, is our own to take. But no, your life doesn't belong to you. Your life does not belong to you. Your life belongs to God because you're created in His image. The question is, do you give yourself to the Lord completely? If you give yourself to the Lord completely, you say, Lord, even though I don't have much, I have this 2 pennies. They're yours anyway. I'm not talking about money. I'm talking about your life, your energy, your time, everything. I said, even if you're 80 years old, like, you know, Caleb, when he was really old, he went to Joshua and said, Joshua, send me. I'm going to take that hill. I'm going to take that place. I'm going to take it for the Lord and for my family as well. Doesn't matter how old you are or how young you are. He said, God, I belong to you. Is that okay to say that? As we sing the last portion of this song here, I want to encourage you. Let's pray this prayer. God, my life belongs to you. And make a count. And it doesn't matter who you bring to me. Doesn't matter. They could be broken. They could be so successful. They could be so wealthy or so poor. Doesn't matter. God used me to touch lives. God used me so I can share the love of Christ with these people. God used me. God sent me. Here I am. Would you stand up before the Lord and let's respond to the Lord with this song once again.
Trust in you alone, and
I am. Here I am, here I am.
Here I am, God.
Oh, here I am.
Oh.
Here I am, here I am. Prayer. Here we are, God. Here we are. Lord, use us. Just like the lyric says, use me to touch those who are around me. Lord, here I am. I don't know what to do. But God, when I see your presence, when I see your glory, I mean, oh God, here I am. God, I don't know what to say except to surrender myself before you. Lord, doesn't matter. Doesn't matter anymore. Anything, nothing matters, God. Here I am. Use me, God. Fill me, God. In the name of our Lord Jesus, this is our prayer. And God's people say, amen. Amen. Turn to your neighbor and say, God will use you. God will use you. Amen. God will use you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Good to have you back, Brian. Finally, I can have somebody to talk to. Hallelujah, hallelujah. It's all right, you guys can talk. Hallelujah. How many know there's presence of God here? Amen. I have game. Yeah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Even though you guys are walking down, I really don't want you guys to leave because you guys done a wonderful job. Thank you. Hallelujah. I'm a bit overwhelmed with what's happening. But I'm really thankful God's doing something wonderful. Meaning hardship. Hardship is good. My wife, I think she's here. Where's my wife? She's sitting in the back. Yeah, she's been sick for the past 4 days. Don't worry, she's not contagious. Yeah, she's isolating herself and she's got some kind of bug, stomach bug. So she's been resting at home, which is great, you know. Hardly see my wife, resting at home. And for the past few days, she's been resting. And funny thing is, I still hear echo. It's me. Anyway, funny thing is, I'm not a very good caretaker. So my wife said, you suck at taking care of me. Okay. Sorry, she said, you're not a good nurse or good caretaker. Okay, I'm not a good caretaker. I'm so sorry. Yeah. And I know I made it, you know, I made it to that. But thank God, the only thing I could do, and I think that's the best thing, is to pray for her. So whenever she was warning, and I was just like, I'll pray for you. That's the only thing I'm good at for now. So, but I'm thankful that she's, hello. Can we turn down the, because I feel like I have a stuffy nose and, you know, the room is too big, sorry. But I'm thankful that she's better now. She's recovering. Thank God that she said, I need to be in a church today. I want to go and worship God. And I said, well, you can stay home and rest. No, I want to be there and worship God. Okay. All right. When you have a strong woman in the house, you know they build up your families. You know, like when you have a strong wife in the house, she builds up your family. Good. Hallelujah. Anyways, what's new? A couple announcements. We all know that the prayer meeting, we have several prayer rooms at this church, two in English, two in Chinese, and some of you already know that. It's not news anymore. This one is quite new. The registration is closed. Yeah, that's it. Registration's closed. Only Tony's like, yay! We got to get things started. Registration is closed. Friday or Saturday is like done. No more. Even if you want to go, there's no spots for you. I think we have already maximized the capacity, which is great. You know, this is, I think, the first retreat that we have ever hosted, ever put together, that, we close our registration a month before the event, which is amazing. You know, usually it's a day before. But it's amazing. Good job, guys. Good job for those people who are actually involved and coordinating. I think, thank you very much, guys. So now what you need to do is pray. If you're not going, raise up your hands if you're not going. It's okay. Raise up your hands. If you're not going, that's okay. Okay. If you don't raise your hand, that means you're lying. Okay, I'm kidding. Okay, it's okay if you're not going. It's okay. You have to wait till next year. Next year, we'll most likely put together another one. But if you're not going, it's okay. You can pray for the retreat. It's okay to pray for the retreat. Pray for people and safety and all that. They get to encounter God. All right, thank you. Next, September 11 this year is our joint service. It's our 17th anniversary. Is our 17th anniversary. In 2005, on September 11th, 2005, it was a Sunday. So 17 years ago, September 11th, it was a Sunday. That's when Impact started the first service. The very first service was on September 11th, 2005. And 17 years later is on Sunday, September 11th. So we want to welcome everybody. So both services are going to come together. It's going to be a joint service. So come. I'm pretty sure this room is going to be packed. Last time we have the event, you know, carnival, and there's many, many new people, and they're slowly coming into this house. So I want to invite all of you to invite your friends. 17th anniversary. Welcome. All right, that will be the last announcement. Thank you. Hallelujah. 17 years. Jennifer, you were there. Yeah, you're old. Oh my goodness, 17 years ago. Hallelujah. Okay, what am I doing here? I think we're going to talk about Bible. Before we start, can we pray? Is that okay? Father, we thank you for coffee. Father, we thank you for everything you've done for us. You're always good. Lord, even when your children reject you, like me, turn down the ideas that you have for me, you still love me. And I thank you for opportunity to repent and to seek your face and turn back to you. And Father, I thank you for your goodness. And thank you, Lord, for continuing to cultivate a hungry heart for you. Thank you, Lord. I bless you. I honor you as we open your word. Lord, open our hearts as well. And everybody would come and hear your word and be blessed by it. In the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen. All right. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God's good. Last time I was here, I talked about fasting. Fasting. And I don't know how many of you guys actually took the opportunity and fasted. If you haven't taken an opportunity to fast, that's okay, because I'm going to come back here. I'm going to talk about it again. You know, I think what the Bible says, you know, Jesus said when the disciples were with him, he said, they don't have to fast. But now, when I'm gone, you will fast. He's basically talking about you here. Okay, you will fast. So honestly, my wife, for the past 3 days, she didn't eat anything. She was forced to fast. She wasn't protesting that hunger strike. But, you know, she was fasting in some way because she couldn't eat. Anything that went in would come out anyway. So, and she said, I lost 3 pounds. And I said, great, honey. You're looking good. No, I'm kidding. I'm just joking. But I think one of the best ways to encounter God is through fasting. Why? Because the Bible says you need to humble yourself. And last time I talked about when you humble yourself, the best way to humble yourself is through fasting. You're giving up your rights to eat. You're giving your rights to drink or to take food and nourish your body. You're giving up that right and no longer seek after your right because you're humbling yourself by surrendering yourself, your rights to look before the Lord. So that's one of the best ways. Bible says that. The funny thing is the Israelites, until today, they will fast one day in a year, at least one day. Everybody, whole nation would fast on that day. That's Yom Kippur, the day of atonement, the date of repentance, the date of, you know, coming to the Lord, put on their sackcloth, and they weep before the Lord, and they cried out and asked the Lord to forgive them. And that's the date of repentance. Today I want to talk about be hungry for God and understand repentance and understand forgiveness. I don't know about you. Sometimes you feel like everything is fine. Everything goes really smoothly. And you feel like your life is great. You just recently bought a new house, have a child, just bought a new car, and got, you know, you got promoted in your job, and your money's coming in, and everybody's happy. You know, there's no in-law issue. There's no children. Why did I hear something? There's no in-law issue, you know. There's no financial, you know, challenges. Everything goes so well in your life. Anybody experience that? If that is you, raise your hand, it's okay. Great. Brian, see, you need to be behind me, okay? There's no problem in my life. The life is so good. You know, you even wear a t-shirt that says life is good, you know? Everything goes so smoothly for you. And that's the time I want to encourage you to start fasting. You want to start fasting. You don't want to wait until the Lord disciplines you. You want to discipline yourself. God, I need you. Even though everything is fine, my bank account is healthy, my marriage is healthy, my relationship with my kids is healthy, you know, I'm doing well at work, everything's healthy, everything's fine, I want to encourage you to be hungry. God, I want to be hungry. I don't want to be satisfied with all this, you know, comfort. Everything seems fine on the outside. Everything's okay. But I need to discipline myself. I need to seek you with everything I got, even though everything seemed fine on the outside. The Bible said, be still and know that he's God. It doesn't mean that be prosperous and know that he's God. It doesn't mean that, oh, be abundant and know that he's God. No, be still. The Bible says, last way I talk about this, be still means don't struggle no more. Don't struggle no more. Meaning you put yourself on the altar and say, God, I'm here as a living sacrifice. I struggle no more and I would know that you are God. Sometimes we think that if I could make it to the top, if I could be successful, if my bank account could reach this amount of money, if my marriage is perfect, if my wife looks perfect on the outside, even though she's 60 years old, she still looked like Sarah described in the Bible. She looks so young, like a 25-year-old girl. We all think that is success. No, that's not true. The Bible never says be successful and know that he is God. The Bible says don't struggle no more. Don't struggle. Your flesh is always struggling. Your flesh doesn't want to come under the Spirit of God. Your flesh always struggling. Oh, I don't want to surrender to the Lord. God says, go, because I want you to go. You say, no, God, you know, I'm comfortable here. I just renovated. My kitchen is nice. I want to stay home. I just bought a new mattress. I want to stay home, and I want to sleep in my own bed. I'm talking about myself, okay? I'm not talking about you. God, I want to go on this mission trip because, you know, it's not easy to go to these nations and do all these things. I'd rather stay home and have AC blow at me, right? How many of you feel that way? I do. See how broken your pastor is, right? I'm so shallow. Sorry. But it's not about me. If my choice, my flesh would say, I want to stay home. My flesh said, I want to stay home. But the Spirit of God says, no, I want you to go. And I need to surrender my flesh. I'm not an awesome person. Sometimes I am, but most of the time I'm not. Most of the time I want to, like, you know, cuddle with my flesh. Flesh, you're so nice. I want to be comfortable here. I want to, you know, eat a nice piece of steak. I want to drink a glass of wine. So good, yes. You know, I'm seeking my self-comfort. But the Lord says, would you be willing to give up your rights? Not necessarily rights, but your comfort. And I say, okay, God, I will do that. It's not because your pastor is always passionate about, oh, Jesus, yes, you know, I'm going to do it for you, die for you, and all that stuff. No, there are times, there are dialogues, conversation I have with the Lord. I have to, you know, negotiate and wrestle with the Lord. God, I don't want to give up. I don't want to leave my wife. God, I don't want to leave my children. I want to stay with them. I'm a homebody. I like to stay home. I'm an introvert. I like to stay home. I don't want to go out. I don't want to talk to people. Do you believe that? Yes, I am. But because our flesh, just like the Bible says, our flesh resists the Spirit of God. That's why we need to submit ourselves, surrender ourselves, especially our flesh, and be hungry for God. When it comes to fasting, it's a way to discipline your flesh. Because you're literally telling your body, your flesh, you're not going to get anything. You're going to be hungry. You're going to be really grumpy. You really want to kill somebody. If you don't get that kind of emotion, you're not really fasting. You're okay. You just, you know, life is still okay. But you feel like, oh, I'm ready to kill somebody. You don't feed me. That means you're really fasting. Your body is on strike. You know, it's like, screaming at you. And that's when you discipline your flesh. That's when you submit yourself under the Spirit of God. So I want to encourage you, even for me, this past week, I was talking after the first service, I was talking with a brother. I said, hey, you lost weight. Did you fast? Did you really, you know, did you take what I taught and you know, put it into practice? I said, oh, no, I wanted to fast. He said, the guy said, I wanted to fast. But that night we had a wonderful beef stew, you know, noodle soup, so I couldn't fast. But I really wanted to fast. I said, good, I'm going to hold you accountable. We're going to start fasting. I said, yes, we're going to start fasting. Why? Not because we're being legalistic. No, not at all. But when we want to seek Lord, we got to do it together. We're going to hold each other accountable, at least fast for a meal. There's somebody call me up this past week, say, you know, Pastor Jack, I've been fasting my dinner for a week straight. But when I fast this week, I didn't really pray. I didn't really pray. Is that okay? I said, well, maybe it sounded like you're on diet, not really fasting. He said, okay, then I know this is the end of the week, but I'm going to keep doing this. I said, well, if you want to fast, you need to pray, okay? You don't want to just fast and watch TV or just, you know, just go on your Instagram and fast. You're torturing yourself. Don't do that. If you're fasting, you decide to fast for a meal or a day, it doesn't matter. You fast and say, God, I seek you. I'm hungry, but I'm hungry for you. I know I'm hungry for burger and Korean barbecue and all that all together. Tacos and everything. All together, but God, more importantly, I'm hungry for you. So anyways, this week I didn't get to fast because, you know, just a lot of things happened. But this one thing that I told myself, I said, can you pray this prayer? God, I'm hungry for you. And I was talking to my spirit, inner man. I said, can you say you're hungry for God? And I said, you, the most handsome man in the world. Why are you laughing? You need to be hungry for the Lord. You need to seek his face. And I think it worked. You know what I mean? You know what it means? It worked. Because I was telling my spirit, I was telling myself, hey, have you thought about God today? Have you thought about God at this moment? Have you thought about God at this minute? Right? The Bible says pray continually, all the time, continual, nonstop. Have you thought about God? Have you talked with God at this second? Are you talking with the Lord as you're listening to somebody talking? Are you following me? When you build that habit in your life, you're always building that connection with the heavenly realm, with God himself. And don't disconnect that. You know, it's like, you know, going back to the days when you have the dial-up service, you know, it's hard, so hard to link up, right? It's so hard to get on the internet. But it's same thing. When you lose that connection, it takes some time to warm it up and, like, you know, start cranking your generator and trying to reach. Yes, God can instantly connect with you. Yes. But sometimes we get so distracted, it takes some time for us to focus. It's not God's problem. It's my problem. It's your problem. You understand that? We're so distracted with this thing, right? We're so distracted with this thing. Yeah. Even though we're listening to sermon, wow, last week, you know, Jonathan and Jennifer preached, so I need to listen to it again. We're so distracted. We listen to sermon, we read about, you know, the Christian articles and all that good stuff, but we're still distracted because we're not taking time reading the word and meditating on the word of God. We're so distracted. So we need to come to the Lord and say, God, I'm hungry for you. And your word says, go back to the word of God. Don't just say, God, you're like wind and I can feel you. No, don't go there. Let's go back to the word of God and meditate on, the Bible says, Psalm 1, meditate on the law of the Lord, day and night. Not meditate on the wind, the earth, the fire, the elements. No, meditate on the word of God. Is that okay? So be hungry for the word of God. Be hungry for what he said. Amen? Be hungry. And what he said today, I want to talk about, how do you stay hungry? There is a key. Of course, there are several, but this one here, it's one of the most important one to me. It's forgiveness. Someone said, I don't know who said this, but somebody said, if you're not hungry for God, you're probably full of yourself. If you're not hungry for God, you're probably full of yourself. You got so much yourself inside, so you have no time, no space for God. And so, and the key of healthy Christian living to me is hunger for God. It's a hunger. When you have a hunger for God, that means you want to eat, you want to take something from the Lord. You need to, either the word of God or in worship or in this communication or the communion, that is the healthy Christian living. And a lot of people, they don't experience or understand God's grace and joy because their hunger for God is so little. Their hunger for God is so little. That's why they don't experience God's goodness. The hunger for the word of God, when I say hunger for God, I'm talking about the word, everything God says, everything God is. You want to be hungry for him. Because our hunger for God is so little, that's why we don't understand him. We don't have the knowledge of God, and we don't experience, we don't encounter who he is. If you're not hungry enough for God, well, let's say this. If you are hungry for God, you most likely will find a way to enter into his presence. You say, God, I want to find a way to find you. I want to find a way to know you, to encounter you. But when we're not hungry for the Lord, we don't take God seriously. The Bible, Jesus said, blessed are those who are hungry for righteousness, right? He will be filled. When we're hungry for righteousness of the Lord, we will be filled. So today, how many of us are hungry for God? I hope that we're all, you know, all the time hungry. Recently, not just yesterday, actually, my mother-in-law came, and my daughter came up to me and said, Daddy, did grandma grow shorter or I grow taller? And I said, oh, what do you think? And she walked away. And why am I saying this? Because my daughter, I don't want to tell you which one. She's been eating a lot lately. She's eating like, you know, a grown-up person, the amount of grown-up would eat. She's eating a lot. And the thing is, they both love sushi, and that's why my bank is broke, you know, everything. They eat a lot. And when they eat, of course, we know this, naturally speaking, physically speaking, we know biologically, we know that they grow. When you eat, you grow. Either up or sideways, either or. Same thing spiritually speaking. When was the last time you really devour his word? When was the last time you took time and said, God, I need to know, I need to eat, you know, everything that you provided me? Okay, so let's take a look Let's take a look what we're going to talk about today. Oh, it's only 3 o'clock? Why is it when you guys talk, time goes by so quickly? Well, I'm up here, it's like, oh, so slow. Oh, God. Hallelujah. There you go. There's a power in the word. All right. I want to talk about two things. Redemption in Christ and fellowship in Christ. I'm going to give you, you know, kind of the bold part. Redemption in Christ. I'm going to talk about forgiveness. Paul, the apostle, wrote, let's all read it together. To the praise, 1, 2, 3. To the praise of his glorious. In him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance to the riches of God's grace that he lavishes on us with all the wisdom and understanding. This is awesome. Basically, the scripture is saying, what does it say? I'm sorry. I'm having too much fun. Paul the Apostle said, there's so much grace for us. There's so much, this glorious grace. And God has provided, God has reserved for us. And this grace is shown, is freely given us in the one he loves. God loves, you know, his son so much. And he's got everything, all, everything. Everybody say all, everything, all to Christ. And through Christ Jesus, we're able to receive all. Amen? So what's in him, what's in Christ? It says we have redemption through his blood. There's blood. There's power in the blood. There's blood that reserved for us. The blood has power. The blood represents life as we all know it. There's life in Christ Jesus and the forgiveness of sins. The forgiveness of sins in accordance with the riches of God's grace. Basically, there are two things. And actually, there's one main thing that I want to emphasize on aside from the blood. Blood represents life. Blood represents cleansing. And this second thing that I want to bring up is the forgiveness of sins. All, meaning through redemption, once we enter into Christ, once we put on Christ, there is redemption. There is this forgiveness for you, and it's free. It doesn't matter the sins that you committed years ago. It doesn't matter if it's the person that you murder, even though murder is a horrible thing to do. You're taking life from the person. It's horrible. You got to pay it back with a life. God is still able to forgive. Can I say that? Maybe it's the lie that you told. Maybe it's the money you stole. And all the things that maybe people that you betrayed, people that you hated, or people that you slept with. And God says, I'm all able to forgive you. There is a forgiveness of sins. And it's available to you, to all of us. And the precondition is in Christ. The precondition is in Christ. And so there is redemption reserved for you and I. And it doesn't matter if it's happening in the past. Maybe it's happening in the present or in the future. Because in God, there's no limit of time. There's no change of shadow of time in God. And it's all forgiven. Let me say it, all forgiven when the precondition is in Christ. So whenever you enter yourself in Christ, into this covenant that you make with God, all sins are forgiven. And this is called positional forgiveness. You position yourself in Christ and all is forgiven. In Christ Jesus, all is forgiven. Everything you've done, the wrongdoings, the sins or the transgression, everything that you've done against other people or other people done to you, everything's forgiven. We all get this clear. It doesn't matter what it is. And it's called positional forgiveness or judicial forgiveness. It's not what you've done to earn it. We cannot earn this. There's no way we can buy it from God. Oh, I'm going to pay for this. No, there's nothing we can do. But it's obtained by every believer in Christ when you enter into Christ. It's obtained by every believer. In our position as member of the body of Christ, we have been forgiven. We have been forgiven of every sin we ever committed or ever will commit. Maybe tomorrow, you're going to say something slanderous. Or tomorrow, you're going to hurt somebody. And the Bible says, all is forgiven. Precondition is in Christ. God, I'm so sorry that I did this. Forgive me. Boom. At the same time, at the same second, a nanosecond, the sin is forgiven. It's not because what we did. So positional forgiveness, that's was given by God in Christ. And that's what the scripture says. And that's the price was paid by Christ when he was nailed on the cross. And we all understood that. And that's the price he paid for. And the payment is already made, and there's no more future payment necessary. So when Jesus said, it is finished, let me ask you, it is finished, what does that mean? It is finished. That's it. You don't have to do anything anymore. We talked about five different sacrifices from the Old Testament a while ago, right? And if Jesus didn't do all these things on the cross for us today, you guys might have to come here with goats and bulls and all the animals. They have to line up. And we, you know, Brian Park would lead a team and start killing animal here. We're going to have to burn the animal. You understand that? But because Jesus died on the cross, he said, it is finished, meaning you no longer have to offer sacrifices. Amen? So that's called positional forgiveness. And for example, this is what I, when I was thinking about this, I'm a father. I have two daughters, beautiful daughters. And I have the responsibility to raise them as a father. And in my house, I cook. So I'm responsible for feeding them. Is that okay to say that? It's okay. You need to feed your child, you know. So I have the responsibility to feed them. And but also it's their privilege. It's their privilege to receive food at the table, right? So I have the responsibility, they have the privilege, so that we work hand in hand. But if they complain about the food that I cook for them, you're too kind. You can be my daughter. You know, in my house, when my daughters eat my, you know, cooking, my food, they'll be like food critics. Daddy, you did good. This part, it's good. Good amount of salt, good amount of pepper, good amount of seasoning, da-da-da. But this, you could do better. So, you know, I'm actually like, what do you call that? One of those, you know, TV show, Iron Chef, that you get all the food critics and going through your dishes. I got chopped, yeah. One of my kids' favorite shows. And anyways, so if they complain about my cooking, do you think, as a good father like me, do you think I will stop feeding them? Of course not. I'll continue to feed them even though, you know, they complain about it, right? Yeah. Just like this. Sometimes we complain about, God, why don't you do this? God, you could have done that. We complain about what God did not do or did do and all these things. We complain about the situation we're in. But it does not stop God from loving us. It does not stop God from forgiving us. When we enter into Christ, do you understand that? The minute we enter into Christ, all sins are forgiven. All complaints forgiven. Everything that we say, you know, the words that, you know, negative words that we said or cuss words that we, everything's forgiven. Can I say that? And that is called positional forgiveness. And my definition, as I was putting this together, as having an access to forgiveness based on his promises. It's not about what you did or what you didn't do. It's not about what you said. It's based on his promise, his word. So God says, I will forgive you the minute you enter into Christ. It's forgiven. In the Old Testament time, the minute you kill the animal and offer it and pray the sin offering prayer, all is forgiven, okay? But tomorrow, you know, sin started to act, you know, accumulate and all that. And you need to offer another sacrifice again for in order for you your sins to be forgiven. That's back in the Old Testament time. But now, the minute you enter into Christ, all is forgiven. And that means having an access to forgiveness based on God's word. All right. But it doesn't mean that the recipient would value the relationship. You understand that? Oh, I'm forgiven. Okay. Thank you. But it doesn't mean that I value this relationship, but it's freely given to, you know, the person. You understand that? And that's called positional forgiveness. And we all have this positional forgiveness. The minute you say, yes, Jesus, oh, I did something wrong, even though you don't know God, even though you don't believe Jesus Christ is your Savior, but the minute you enter into Christ, it's, okay, I don't know God, but I'm sorry, God, help me, forgive me. Boom. you're forgiven. Remember the one criminal that was nailed next to Jesus? He didn't know about Christ. He heard of him. He never went through the discipleship 101. He never went through all the miracle signs and wonder training that Jesus hosted. But the minute he said, yes, I need you, Jesus turned to him and said, yeah, you're going to be with me. Are you with me? That's called positional forgiveness. You and I, we all have this. The minute you enter into Christ, God, I know I did a lot of horrible things. Forgive me. Yeah. Boom, it's forgiven. But still, it takes us to the next level. Remember, I talk about my daughters. And imagine this. My daughters, even though they complain about the food that I provide them, most likely it's made by Annie. I'm kidding. I'm joking. She makes great sandwiches. Even though they complain about food, oh, Daddy, and I know the food's perhaps not as good, okay? Oh, Daddy, the food's not good. But thank you, Daddy. You've done a great job. My daughter started to praise me. Let's say, oh, Daddy, you work so hard. Thank you so much. You've done a wonderful job. I love you. You know, it's okay. You can try it next time. That is going from positional relationship, connection, to the next level of connection. That is called fellowship. That is called relational connection. This week, it's kind of chaotic in my family. I want to be total transparent with you guys. Is that okay? Just like, you know, I was inspired by Jennifer last week. She was so transparent. And I want to be transparent too. This week, you know, aside from my wife's being sick, you know, school is about to start. So I was so, you know, enthusiastic, you know, thinking maybe my daughters would need brand new desks because their previous desk is kind of wobbly and all that. So I went to IKEA and bought 2 brand new desks because they're on sale. Anyway, yeah, hallelujah. Praise Jesus for IKEA. So I bought them back. You know, IKEA. The thing about IKEA is you have to assemble them together. And that's the downside. Anyway, so and my house, my sink was, you know, anyway, something wrong with the sink, and I had to repair the sink. And, you know, I was doing all this work, and it got so messy. The sink wasn't working for about 3-4 days, and it was just like, oh, everything was, I want to get things done, okay? I want to get things done. So I repaired the sink, you know, and got myself, you know, sweaty and all that. And now it was about 10:30, 11-ish, and I'm like, I'm going to assemble this desk. How many dads would do that? Yeah, all the dads would do that. I want to get things done now, you know. I want to get it done like tomorrow, you know. No, today. I'll get it done. Even though I'm sweaty, I'm tired, and like, oh. Anyway, so IKEA. God bless IKEA. So I started assembling these pieces. And sometimes it got me so frustrated. But I still managed to, like, you know, take care of everything. And my kids were watching TV. Annie was doing her thing. And got to the point where I said, Anya, come and help me hold this thing. You know, it got bigger, it's a desk. Help me hold this thing. My wife ran out of the office. She said, let me do it. Let me do it. Wow, how heroic. Let me do it. She got over here. I turned around. I was going to grab some pieces or something. Bam, it fell down. I broke the desk. Oh my God, I was so mad. Can you imagine? I was so mad. Oh my gosh, I was so mad. And I was like 11-ish, you know, late in the night, the doors open because it was hot, you know. And I was like, blah, 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 blah. I was saying words of blessings, you know, sort of thing. Oh. The next thing you see is my daughters quickly turn off the TV and run into their room. They didn't even finish the movie they were watching. They just ran into their room looking for shelter. Oh. And I was so mad. I was so mad at myself, honestly. I was so mad at myself. And I was just yelling, like, wah! Of course, I didn't cuss or anything, of course, in front of my kids, no. I was just like, Lord help me. My wife just silently walked away. I was so mad at myself. And I was just sitting over there, and I was just, oh, it's broken. Then, anyways, and it was all quiet now. Then I just lay flat on the floor, just like, oh, I'm so tired, I'm so sweaty, and all that, so dirty. And I was just like, God. Anyways, I just want to be honest, you know, and this is the emotion I, you know, I had. And I wasn't like hating my kids, nothing. I wasn't like angry at my wife or anything, which is like, you know, why did I ask them for help, you know? So I was, anyways. So after 5-10 minutes, I was just like, oh, darn it. You know, maybe I don't want to do it anymore. I'll fix it tomorrow if I could fix it, da, da, da. So I went showering. You know, I went and took a shower. And after taking a shower, I feel much better, okay? Brothers, husbands, when you're frustrated, go take a shower. There's healing in the rain. There's healing in the water. Holy Spirit, I need you. Oh, God. Or maybe it's the shampoo I use or something. Finally, I got more relaxed, you know. Then I felt bad. Honestly, I felt horrible. I felt so bad about, you know, screaming and raising my voice at my kids. I felt terrible. And, of course, my wife, she's like pretending she's working hard. She didn't talk to me. And I went to my daughter's room. And I went over there and I turned to one of the girls, of course, later to the other one. I said to the youngest one, now I'll tell you which one. I said to my youngest daughter, who's 9 now, I said, Bree, I'm so sorry that Daddy raised his voice earlier. I'm sorry, would you forgive me? And of course, you know, there's just dim lights and all that. She looked at me like she was laying down. She said, Daddy, I know you are tired, and I know you've done so much today, and it's okay. Well, I'm, you know, basically said, I forgive you. It's okay. You need some rest. And I had tears, you know, like, oh, I'm so sorry. I shouldn't have done that, and I want to apologize to you. And she said, it's okay, Daddy. I know you're tired. You need to get some rest. And she said, you smell good. Then I went to another, my oldest daughter, and I said the same thing. And, you know, we hug and all that. And why am I saying this? Is because they know that I'm their father. They know that I love them. But what's more important is the relationship. It's that reconciliation. It's that... It's no longer, not just I'm your father, you're my child, but I want to move on to I'm your father, that I want to build this close, intimate relationship with you. That is moving from positional forgiveness to this relational forgiveness. The reason I want reconciliation is so that we can have better relationship. Are you with me? We can walk together. And let's take a look at the story. Back in the days, in the Bible, we're going to talk about the Bible. We all know these three different characters. And I mentioned that last time when I was talking here on the subject of fasting. David, Bathsheba, and Uriah. The story goes, David found this beautiful woman, slept with her. She's pregnant, and her husband is one of the generals. So instead of killing this general, Uriah, himself, he, you know, set up a trap, and he sent this general over to the front line and had him killed by the enemies. So he was able to take this woman, Bathsheba, into his palace and marry her, like, you know, officially. So we know the story. And after this story, and I also talked about that last time, I said, things kind of like settled down. Nobody knew about this because he did it in secret. Only a handful of people knew about this. But somehow, Nathan, a prophet, came to David And he came to David and he gave David a story, an analogy, a parable that, you know, about a rich man and a poor man. They both have, you know, an animal. The poor man has one sheep, one little sheep. And the rich man has got flocks and herds and a lot of. We know that the rich man, you know, wanted to, you know, treat the guests and feast. The rich man actually had the poor man's lamb killed. So the poor man ended up with no lamb, nothing of his own. Right? We know the story. Then the Bible says David got so furious. He got so furious. He was so angry. He said, "Who is this wicked man? Who is this wicked man? I'm going to kill him." Right? We all know that. Nathan said, "It's you." We know the story. As I was contemplating on this story, of course, we talk about the humility of David. But I also want to talk about the courage of Nathan. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Nathan, if you were Nathan, would you do that? You walk into the king's palace, and you point at the king's nose and say, "You are a murderer." Not you, Marvin. Okay, don't worry. You are the murderer. If you were Nathan, you're committing suicide, to be honest with you. This is suicide attack. What, God, you want me to go into the palace? You want me to point it at the king's nose and say, "You are a murderer. You are a wicked man. God, are you sure? We need to be politically correct, God." I don't want to stir the water, God. I don't want to talk about politics. Right? If we were to bring it to our modern day, you know, scenario, oh God, no, we don't want to talk about politics here. Not in the palace. No. Right? Not in the church. No. I'm a man of God. I should be talking about the word of God. No, this Nathan guy, a prophet of God, he publicly talk about politics and in front of the king. Man, that requires so much courage. I pray that some of you become Nathan, not me, but some of you. I don't have that kind of courage. I really believe that this is what, you know, the kind of courage we need to have nowadays. We need to have the courage to speak the truth and not being afraid of offend anybody. Because it is true. But how many of us are actually telling the truth loud and clear? King, you messed up. Imagine you would go to the governor of California and say, "You messed up. God's going to deal with you and he's going to, your family's going to be cursed, da, da, da." That's what Nathan said. We wouldn't do that. But why not? Have you thought about that? Oh, it's just a Bible story. It doesn't apply to today's, you know, situation. Really? Even the kids disagree with that. Yes, it does apply because the word of God is the same forever. Anyways, I'm not talking about Nathan today, but I want to talk about David. Now, David said, it's over here. David said to Nathan, "I have sinned against the Lord. I have sinned against the Lord." This is one picture that came to me. He was sitting, imagine this, he was sitting in his throne, right? As a king, sitting in his throne. Wow. Maybe the palace is, you know, bigger than this. And there are soldiers, right? Armed soldiers around him. Nathan walked slowly, trembling, perhaps. I don't know, maybe he didn't tremble. I would walk over to the king and told a story. "You are the wicked man." The king could have said, "Secret Service, kill him," right? No, the king could have said, "Arrest him." The king could have said, you know, "Take this man away and kill him right away." The king could have said all these things. But instead, the picture I had was King David arose and he got down to his knees. I believe he got down to his knees. He said, "I have sinned against the Lord." That is humility. That is humility. When you've been called out, when somebody calls you out, you have lived a sinful lifestyle. Don't do it no more. It's not because they hate you. It takes tremendous courage for them to call somebody out. Can I say that? It takes tremendous courage for a pastor to call you out. I tell you, a lot of pastors will be, oh, no problem. God loves you. Keep on drinking, sinning, keep on doing all these bad things. A lot of pastors, they don't care. But when a pastor has courage enough courage, they will call you and say, don't do this no more. That is sin. Not because they hate you. I told a story before. And there was a theologian, a person that got 2 master's degree from Fuller Seminary, understood Greek and Hebrew, that came to Impact years ago. He's a homosexual Christian. He believed that, homosexuality is the will of God. And he debated with me and with Paul and all that. And I remember I told the story. I said, at a Starbucks, he and I sat down. And I'm thinking, God, I don't have 2 master degree from Fuller Seminary. I don't even have a master degree. I don't have a master's degree, but doesn't mean anything. But Lord, how am I going to debate with this person who believes that homosexuality is the will of God, it's the perfect will of God? How am I going to win this so-called debate? He opened up his Bible and is ready to challenge me. I'm thinking, oh, I don't know what to say. I didn't even know where to start. And I pray, I said, God, help me. Some of you never knew the story, but I want to quickly tell you this. At that moment, I said, okay, you and I, we have different viewpoints. You know, you have different views on homosexuality. But let's agree on something. Let's talk about something that we both agreed on. Let's start with something that's in common. Do you agree that one day you will die? Because I agree one day I will die. Do you agree? Of course, he's not going to say, I'll live forever. He said, yes, one day I will die. I said, do you agree that one day that you will stand before God's great white throne? You know, doesn't matter what his eschatology is about, but he said, yes, I believe that one day I will stand before the Lord and give my account. Okay, we both agree on this. So I said, do you think, and I asked him another question, do you think when I stand before God one day, give my account, God would ask me whether I won the debate or not? Do you think God's going to ask me if I won that debate or not? Or he's going to ask me whether I love the person that he brought to me? And he heard that, he closed his Bible. And he started telling me his brokenness, his childhood, and you know, the kind of abuse that he went through. So that led him to this place. He started coming to Impact for about 2 years. And during that 2 years, I didn't change him. I didn't change his perspective, his viewpoint on homosexuality. He didn't change my perspective on, you know, what I believe from the Bible. But we honor each other, but I still say, this is what I believe. This is what I believe. But I'm called to love you. I love you, but sin is sin. I didn't say that. I didn't reject you. I love you, but this is what the Word says. And he could say, well, this is what the Word says. You know, this is what I believe. Anyways, 2 years later, he moved to another country. But every now and then, he writes me Christmas cards and all that and, you know, say thank you very much and all that stuff. What I'm trying to say is, For the king, David, for David to humble himself by standing in truth, humble himself and standing in truth, that's what made him the man after God's own heart. Yes, he repented before the Lord, but he still believed that the Lord is gracious and merciful. Then Nathan said to David, the Lord, Nathan said to David, The Lord has put away your sins. Right there, the minute you say, I am sorry, forgive me, I have sinned against God, the Bible says the Lord already forgave you. The minute you said it, the Lord has put away your sin, and you shall not die. However, by this deed, you have given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme. The child also who is born to you shall surely die. Even though there's consequence to the behavior, to the deed. His sins forgiven. So in other words, God forgave David immediately. And David, as David confessed his sin, as he entered into Christ. Back in the days, there was no Christ. But to us, as we enter into Christ, as we understand there's a saving grace for us, the sin is forgiven. And that's called positional forgiveness. We understand that. So David, when he repented after this incident, he wrote Psalm 51. We all know Psalm 51. And Psalm 51 is one of my favorite psalms. It started with this: have mercy upon me, God. Have mercy upon me, God, according to your loving kindness, according to the multitude of your tender mercies, bolt out my transgressions. And continue on and says, God, how merciful you are. God, you're a merciful king. You're so gracious. All in the beginning of Psalm 51 is talking about how good, how faithful God is, how loving God is. I don't know about you, but if I were David, somebody called me out, like, oh, you're such a terrible person, and I was the king. If I was the king and somebody called me out, I would be so furious. I would be so angry. How dare you? I'm the king of this nation. You don't know who you're talking to. I'll be so full of pride. But instead, David, he knew that he was only a servant to the Lord. He humbled himself. He said, God, I know who you are, God. You're merciful. You're full of grace. Lord, I come before you and I pray for the child. God, forgive me. And he continues on and says, in this prayer, he said, you may be found just when you speak. Even though I come to you knowing you're gracious, knowing you're merciful, I know you're just too. When you speak, you're full of just. You're full of righteousness, and you're blameless when you judge. God, you're the ultimate judge. You're the ultimate judge, and I know who you are. Then he continues to say, let's take a look together. This is my favorite part. He says, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Create in me, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit in me. And renew a new spirit. Renew a steadfast spirit within me. God, I know I was a filthy person. I was a wicked person. But now, God, I come to you. Create in me a new heart. I no longer just want a position of forgiveness. I want our relationship to be restored. I know you have already forgiven me, but Lord, I want to feel your presence. I want to be renewed. I want to feel your presence. And that's translating from positional forgiveness into relational forgiveness. I crave for that relationship. I crave for that fellowship. It says, do not cast me away from your presence and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation. Restore to me the joy of your salvation. When we're sinning against the Lord, I tell you, the first thing that you're going to miss is the joy of God. It's the joy of the Lord. You feel ashamed and there's no joy coming out of the well of your spirit. When you walk away from the Lord, you instantly lose that joy. You instantly lose the glory of God. The joy of salvation is that you can be free doing what God's calling you to do. You can be free. We all know this, and we'll talk about this. Freedom. Freedom. Oh, it's not about you can freely do whatever you want. Freedom is not freely doing whatever you want. It's you can choose freely. You don't have to do certain things. But when you're addicted to something, you have to do it, then that doesn't mean that you have freedom. So continue to say, uphold me by your generous spirit. And the last thing he says, the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit and a broken and a contrite heart. These, O God, you will not despise. These, O God, you will not despise. The contrite heart. When was last time you and I would come to the Lord with a contrite heart? When was last time you come and pounding your, God, I'm such a sinner. Yes, God. I did this, and Lord, I'm not proud of. God, I need you. God, I need you. God, I need you. God, I need you. Forgive me. When was the last time you had the tear coming out of your eyes and, God, without you, I'm nothing? I often ask myself, when was the last time I had tears coming down of my eyes when I worship the Lord? Or when I think about God, there's tear coming out without any reason. I remember years ago, I shared a testimony. I don't mind sharing it quickly again. I went through a lot of things during my first year of college. And all the things that I shouldn't have done, I did it. You know, as a Christian, I did everything, like all these things. And I was like, whoa, this was fun. Sin always tastes fun in the beginning, you know, all these things that God hates. All fun in the beginning. Oh, yeah, this is fun. This is fun. This is fun. But after a while, I realized, you know what? I miss the joy of salvation in my life. I miss that. Long story short, I was at a retreat, and I was 21 years old, which was a couple years ago. And I found myself on my knees crying out. I just cry because the song that was sang was Psalm 51. Create in me a new heart, God. Cast me not away. And all of a sudden, I burst out in tears. God, I am such a horrible person. God, forgive me. I remember pounding my heart. I was pounding my heart. God, forgive me. And I was speechless. I couldn't burst out any words. I was just crying, and as loud as I could, I cried and cried for 3-4 hours, crying. Everybody left. Maybe rapture or something, and I was the only one there. And I was just crying, Lord, and I got up like nobody's here. And I thought it was crazy. Because I remember I went to a very traditional evangelical Baptist church. Okay. You don't cry in the midst of worship. You properly open your hymn book and you sing from Psalm 325. You sing twice, you sit down. That's the church that I went to. But I was on the floor crying my eyes out for hours and hours. I thought I went crazy. But I had to tell you, after that incident, I got up after the retreat. Randomly, I walk in the college campus. I sat there in the campus, and I start crying out of nowhere. I saw people walking by me, and I start crying for these people. I said, they're going to hell, and I start crying. I don't know if you have this kind of experience that you are so hungry for God. Say, God, I need you. And God fill you up. You're so like, I know what I am now. I know I belong to you. And have this burning desire to see more of God in your life. Listen, I didn't go to a charismatic church. I had no clue what happened. I had no clue I was baptized in the Holy Spirit. I started speaking a different tongue. I had no clue. But when I sat there in the college campus, I saw people walking by me. I said, they're going to hell. What am I going to do? God, help me. God, equip me. God, train me. But I didn't know what to do except for crying. And I want to say this. The reason I'm saying this is because when you have that desire, God, I'm hungry for more of you. God, I'm hungry for more of you. God will fill you up. The question is, after God fill you up, what are you going to do about it? God, use me. God, here I am. Oh, praise God, I'm running out of time. Thank you for journaling with me. When was the last time you cried during your worship? Maybe it's corporate, during a corporate worship. Maybe it's a personal devotional time. I don't know. But when was the last time you said, God, create in me a new heart. Create in me a new heart. Maybe your life goes so well, so smoothly. Doesn't matter. you still can say, God, I'm so hungry, even though everything is nicely positioned. God, I still need you. John the Apostle, he said this. We're coming to the last point. John Apostle mentioned this. If we confess our sins, we all know this scripture, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. When we confess our sins, he is just, he is righteous, he forgives and he cleanses us. That's a wonderful promise that God's given us. The minute we confess our sins, but when this in this case, it's not about the position of forgiveness anymore. It's about relational forgiveness. The reason I confess my sin is so that I can come closer to you, God. It's so that I can rebuild this relationship with you. You understand that? When the minute you say, cast my not away, Holy Spirit, I still need you. Don't cast the Spirit of God away from me. I still need you. That means you care about this relationship. You care about the friendship, the fellowship you have. So the difference between Ephesians chapter 1, 6 to 8 and 1 John chapter 1, 9 is that John is basically talking about this relational forgiveness like a father to a son. For example, a father and a son. If a son, for example, I'll use my daughter. Okay, a daughter and a father. A daughter and a father. When my daughter does something wrong or, you know, make a mess or something that I'm not supposed to do or falling short of the expectation or, you know, like breaking rules, for example, the daughter would hinder the relationship, the fellowship with the father. The daughter would hinder the relationship. Of course, their relationship is still the father and the daughter. But the son or the daughter would hinder the relationship between the two of them. She still remained as a daughter to the father. The relationship's still there. But the connection is falling apart until the daughter confessed her sin and seeking for reconciliation. That makes sense?
Yeah, good.
So that is relational forgiveness. It's not just, oh, I know that I am forgiven. I'm in Christ and I'm forgiven. It's God, I want my sins to be forgiven so that I can be with you. The being part is what I'm after. It's not a knowing part. Knowing that I'm forgiven is being with you. That is what I'm after. And that's a different level of forgiveness. So confession of sin will help us. Will help to keep us from the discipline of the Lord. When we confess our sin, that God, forgive me of my sins. When we confess, that's when we enter into forgiveness. If we don't know what's wrong in this relationship, we don't know where to confess from. You understand that? God, I'm sorry I did something wrong. Oh, I don't know what I did wrong. So God, would you shine your light into my heart so I can see? If we don't ask the Lord to shine his light into our hearts, then we don't know what happened. Or maybe you should start reading the Word. That will tell you more. If we haven't had a chance to read the Word, at least ask the Holy Spirit to shine his light into our hearts. For example, another example with my daughters. I love making fun of my... I love talking about my daughters. At our house, there is this kind of rules. Almost every night, that would tuck them in. Either my wife or I would tuck them in, pray a prayer, and you know, talk with them for a very quick 5 minutes and all that. But there is this one set policy that is, if I'm not shower, because they take shower, they go to bed. If I'm not shower, I cannot hug them in their bed. I cannot snuggle with them, okay? Because I'm like filthy and dirty and sweaty and all that. So if I shower, if daddy or mommy shower, I can jump into their bed and snuggle with them. That's really sweet. I think so. And that being said, there's this thing. I love my daughter so much, so I want to, you know, snuggle with them. What does that mean? It means I want to be with them. I don't want this dirty, filthy cloth or the smell to hinder us, to stop us from connecting. You understand that? So I'm willing to take off this filthy clothes and take a shower and smell good and snuggle with my daughter before they go to bed. Same thing. It's about a relationship. It's not about the understanding. Understanding is a position. Like, oh, I am forgiven because he loves me. He's my God, and I get it. I don't necessarily value this kind of relationship, even though I know I'm forgiven, like I mentioned earlier. But with this relational forgiveness, it's about I want that relationship. I want that connection. I want to be intimate. And that's where we need to be at. Remember, David pray. I'm going to wrap it up here. David pray, God, save my son. Forgive me. Don't cast your spirit, away from me. Forgive me. I pray for my son so that he can come alive. The Bible says, no, the son died. He was on the floor for 7 days. Either way, okay? He was on the floor for 7 days, didn't eat, didn't drink, 7 days praying, God, save my son. The Bible says, the servants came to David and said, your son died, your majesty. What did David do? Ah! Right? No. David got up, dusted himself up, bring me food and wine. I'm going to start eating. No, he didn't dwell in the past. He didn't question, God, why didn't you ask? Save him. God, why didn't you do this? He didn't blame God. He got up. He said, I hear you. All right, let's go. He didn't question God at all. Before God took his son away, he fasted, he prayed, and he said, God, he was silent, but he prayed, God, I need you, save my son. After his son was taken away, he got up. He knew God's still in control. How about us? I know some of us, we recently went through a hard time, losing our loved ones. It's very difficult. I know I went through it. My wife and I, we lost our child too. I don't understand. But God, I know you're still in control. Dust myself off. It's called, keep going. Keep believing. He didn't question at all. Then he wrote Psalm 9 after his son died. Let's take a look. He wrote Psalm 9, if you will. Open your Bible to Psalm 9. In Psalm 9, he says, I will praise you, O Lord, with my whole heart. That's how he started. I will praise you with my whole heart, God. Even though he took my son away, I'll praise you with my whole heart. I will tell all your marvelous works. Not only I will praise you, I will tell everybody your marvelous work. Remember, that's what happened after his son passed away. I'll be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High. And he goes on and on how much he was thankful for, how much marvel, how much he knows about God, how much he praises God. Then going down to verse 12 to 14, this is what it says. He does not forget the cry of the humble. God, I humble before you. I cry before you for my child. Even though you took my child away, I know you're marvelous. I know you're faithful. I will continue to tell your goodness. And you who lift me up from the gates of death, that I may tell of all your praise in the gates of daughter of Zion. I will rejoice in your salvation. The whole chapter is filled with positive, this outcome, this positive, this the praises, this, understanding who God is. It's not just dwell in his past, his sadness or his misfortune. He shift his eyesight, he shift his focus from all the misfortune to who God is. And that's called relational forgiveness. It's about that relationship. God, I know I'm forgiven because I'm called to love you. I'm called to rebuild this relationship with you. After I come back to the Lord, of course, there are several times that I ran away from God, several times. I tell you, I'm such a a horrible person. That was my Christian walk. I left the church. I left God many times. I walked away from the Lord multiple times. The reason I'm saying this is because a lot of us, we just want the position of forgiveness. God, I know you forgive me. I confess my sin. You know, that's it, done. Doing my Christian duty. Oh, okay. God forgive me. I'm ready to go to heaven. But God wants to move you from positional forgiveness to relational forgiveness. Because he cares about that relationship. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you. You're always good. You're always good. Sometimes we don't understand. A lot of time, we don't understand what's going on. When the hardship comes, when the wave become stronger in our lives, Lord, we lose a direction. We lose a focus. But Lord, we ask you today, would you clear out the waves? Would you clear out the wind? Would you clear out the clouds? Father, help us. Help us to see where we should be heading to. In the name of Jesus, if some of you today, you're going through this hardship, I feel like the Lord is saying that you're losing a sense of direction. You're losing a sense of purpose in your life. And I want to say to you that the Lord is transitioning you from knowing that you're forgiven to this relationship with Christ. Some of you feel like you lost a sense of hope. Even though the clouds being cleared out, you got into this depression mode. You say, God, how come you didn't hear my prayer? I want to tell you, you're in the right place. It's that question that's going to lead you to that hunger for God. God, how come you didn't hear my prayer? God, I need you. You're not standing at a higher ground commending God or questioning God, but you're coming down to your knees. God, I don't know what happened, but I need you. I don't know why my prayer wasn't answered, but God, I'm hungry for you. I'm hungry for your presence. God, I want to be like King David. He got up, he dusts himself off, and he goes into the temple of the Lord. He worshiped God. And he wrote a psalm to praise God. God, I don't know a lot of things, but one thing I know, that you are good and you're loving, and I can trust you. And I praise you, for you are my Father in heaven, and you look after me. In the name of our Lord Yeshua, amen and amen.
Oh, God.
But he did the best thing that could ever happen to us. He laid down his life and said, I long to reconnect with you. I long to embrace you. I long to snuggle with you. Just like my daughters and I long to be with you. So Jesus created me a clean heart. I don't just want to know about forgiveness. God, I want to experience forgiveness. God, forgive me. I'm hungry for you. I'm hungry for your righteousness. I'm hungry for the hope in Christ. I'm hungry for your mercy and your love. So God, fill me up. In Jesus' name.
I am Jesus, I am yours, and I am yours, and I am yours, all my days, Jesus, I am yours, sing, I am yours, I am yours, all my days, Jesus.
Spirit is moving here and touching hearts. I want you to grab a cup and find somebody that you can bless and pray for the person and say, Holy Spirit, speak to that individual. Holy Spirit, I pray for that person that his heart may be restored, that he can rebuild this relationship with you, God, because what Jesus did on the cross for the person, Lord, we thank you. I believe the Holy Spirit is touching your heart tonight in the name of Jesus, that you don't want to walk away from his presence, but instead you say, God, I'm hungry for you. I'm hungry for you. I'm hungry for you, Jesus. Whenever you're ready, come and take a cup. Find somebody, ask the Holy Spirit to highlight somebody that you can bless, highlight somebody you can pray for, in Jesus' name.
Bottom up.